Good afternoon, everyone. This is Falguni, and you are watching Candid at Ciceroni. Ahmedabad has evolved in the fashion scenario in last one decade monumentally. We see celebrated designer wear and celebrated designers coming to town like nobody's business. And today we have with us Nachiket Barve. Welcome, Nachiket.
Pleasure. Good to be in Ahmedabad always.
Which is fantastic, right?
Absolutely. I love it.
Goes back to your academic...
A lot of fond memories. You know, I think as a designer, in a way, I found myself in the city. So it's always good to be back.
Brilliant. I would want to give the viewers a little background and a fantastic profile that Nachiket has. So to give you a little background, he has done his undergraduation in commerce and economics, and he moved on to kind of study here in Ahmedabad. He studied at NID. Thereafter, he received a scholarship and went and studied in Paris in an institute called ENSAD. He's interned at Celine. He was awarded as, I have a lot of awards to mention there.
Yeah, you've done your research.
I've done my research. So he was awarded the Gen Next Award by Lakme Fashion Week back in 2010. He was also given Fashion Entrepreneur Award, the Young Fashion Entrepreneur to check out for by Elle and by British Council. In 2016 and 17, he received the Hallmark Fashion Award for the India-Pakistan region. And that's a terrific profile that we have of Nachiket.
Well, you're kind.
So let's begin from the start for everyone. Mm-hmm. Going back to the undergrad days, economics and commerce, and how did it translate to going to fashion? What prompted you?
It's even stranger. So everybody in my family is a doctor.
Fantastic.
So we have, I think, every kind of doctor available on call. So there is gastroenterologists and plastic surgeons and uro-onco-surgeons. So our home WhatsApp group is deathly because it's got all kind of things that you don't want to talk about or think about when you're having dinner. But coming from that background, I think fashion and specifically design was something that always interested me right from my childhood days. Okay. And we were talking back in the 90s when, you know, fashion was just a blip on the radar.
Correct.
So it was parents naturally, you know, I mean, they knew nothing and nobody in fashion. So
Correct.
They said, why don't you finish your academics,
Correct.
Make sure you get a solid footing and then decide if this fancy of yours continues or, you know, there is some real material here or just, you know, a hankering for a different kind of a profession.
Correct.
So I actually lived in New Zealand for 2 years after I did my 12th.
Okay.
And then I finished my commerce graduation, which was a solid career choice to get into.
Sure.
And then from there, I actually applied for NID and NIFT.
Okay.
And I met the professors at NID to ask them if, you know, whatever sketches I was making had any potential, because my staple diet was only fashion magazines and books at that point of time.
Correct.
And they seemed to say that, yeah, like this looks, you know, something which the industry would be happy to accept. And I got through both NID and NIFT, fortunately, after being a commerce graduate, which was quite a shocker to my parents as well.
How exciting.
And well, then NID happened. That set the ball rolling, really, in that sense.
So I think there's a very interesting thing to notice that how the parents are doctors, how they wanted you to kind of finish your education first and then think about all things fashion, because that was a very different decade we are talking about.
You know, it was a very different decade, and I think even today a lot of people get into the business of fashion, and I specifically choose the word business of fashion for reasons which have nothing to do with fashion itself.
True.
So whether it's wanting to dress celebrities or hobnob with a, you know, a glamorous kind of jet set or whatever, those are not incentives that you choose a career for.
Precisely.
You do it because you have a calling for the craft, and of course parents being parents were concerned that, you know, to sort of get a firm footing before you venture into this.
Sure.
But they were very supportive at the same time, which was way before its time, because I was a pretty good academic student and I had like 90 plus in my 10th. And,
sure.
And they could have very easily asked me to, you know, pushed me gently though forcefully to medicine, which right. didn't happen.
Right.
And they said, I remember this conversation with my mom, and she's like, you know, do whatever you want to do, just do it well and do it with all your integrity. I think that's really important.
That's very, very important.
So
how was your learning from NIT, which is a very multicultural exposure, to kind of studying in Paris and thereafter interning at Celine? There are a lot of cultural exposure that kind of happens during the three major juncture of your career. How did it shape you?
you know, as a child as well, I was very interested and influenced by world culture and, you know, people, which you see even now in my clothes.
Yes.
And I think my perhaps first kind of exposure happened when I lived by myself in New Zealand, you know, as a teenager. And I had a job at a fast food restaurant cleaning dishes and, you know, cleaning the kitchen, and I could make a burger in 7 seconds.
Nice.
So it was just something which exposes you to people across nationalities, across genres, across cultural and social backgrounds.
Right.
And learns you to sort of imbibe all of that into your world viewpoint. And NID, I think, was fantastic because, I mean, as an institution in terms of academics, as well as the kind of melting pot of people, cultures and disciplines that it is, it
yes.
really opens you out to the world, at the same time intensely making you aware of yourself.
Correct.
So you learn to become a better professional, interact and engage better with different kinds of people.
Correct.
And then I remember NID had a scholarship where it was an exchange program where one student would be sent abroad every year from the postgraduate disciplines, across disciplines, to study in Paris.
Yeah.
And that I got selected for, which was a brilliant opportunity because you're talking of living in Paris in 2003-04, before the big brands came here and before the magazines, like, you know, international titles came here. So it was amazing because I was studying at ENSAD, or Ecole des Arts Décoratifs, and it was again like all kinds of students, a different way, and just being physically in Paris at that point of time. And then working with Celine, you know, where you have the likes of, say, Anna Wintour backstage at the shows, or you have, you know, when Michael Kors is the creative director. So that was a kind of a seeing the world at a different scale and a different kind of a global viewpoint.
Sure.
At the same time, it intensely made me realize how Indian I really was. I distinctly remember this one conversation at the Celine studio. And they were talking about how in the 50s their grandmothers would wear, you know, Madras checks to the beach. And I'm like, my grandmother never wore a swimsuit to the beach. Like, you know, there was only saris. So then that kind of led me to the idea of being intensely aware of how Indian I really was. And how internationally, to stick to fashion, you have to follow that format.
Right.
And what I wished to express was strangely Indian in a way. At the same time, it was global because of my exposure and the kind of generation we belong to.
Correct.
So I think that kind of striding those two boats gave the initial idea of birthing this brand,
right,
which was the beginning of what one would say was a global local wave in Indian design, you know, where you are aware and exposed to the West and global trends, but you still have something which is inherently Indian, which you cannot shirk away from.
Correct.
So it sort of bred a whole different kind of design language, which right from my first Gen X collection, it's always been about Indian textiles. So I work a lot with Indian fabrics. I work extensively with Indian techniques. So whether it's applique, embroidery, the kind of palette that I sometimes inherently or naturally am drawn towards, yet the expression is something which you can pick something and wear something in Ahmedabad or Mumbai or Paris or Tokyo.
You could just translate it.
You could, and I think that's how, you know, all our lifestyles are.
Correct.
We all have a local cultural history and identity, yet we feel at home whether you are, you know, sitting in Boston or you're sitting in Melbourne or you're sitting anywhere in the world. We carry a part of ourselves, yet we embrace the world. And I think that's the kind of philosophy which I think these clothes capture as well.
Brilliant. So you very beautifully mentioned about the design language that has changed in the the collections or in the country in general. You know, in the last 5 to 6 years, we have realized that the fashion lexicon has changed in the country. We see there is sudden revival. Sudden, I wouldn't say, but it has been a process. Revival of the textiles, resurgence of saris in the modern avatars. Last 4 years, you would see there are a lot of covered up blouses. You know, the silhouettes, the cuts, the textures, everything is changing quite a lot, and it is getting very, very inward or very, very local. What are your comments on the current cultural geopolitical scenario that impacts any fashion decade?
I think, see, fashion, like Coco Chanel said, is something in the air. So it's not, it doesn't derive influences out of a vacuum.
Right.
It's always subtly or directly inspired by world events, what the economy looks like, what politics looks like, what the state of the ecology looks like, for example. But at the same time, I think what you're seeing in India is a whole generation which in the last decade and progressive generations, which have sort of really truly become global local.
Yeah.
As opposed to people earlier. Like, you know, there was a time when the kind of thought of made in India or embracing Indianness was shocked upon or looked down upon.
Yeah.
The rebound of that is where you go intensely Indian. And then somewhere the needle kind of finds its own equilibrium by finding this middle point which is individual for everybody. So there is somebody who feels intensely Indian and wants to say wear a sari on a daily basis. Whereas there's somebody who feels more global and will wear a pantsuit because she feels like that. And maybe in the evening wear a sari. So I think today what you see in fashion is an influence, and I think the biggest change in this, if I may say, has been social media and the internet.
Sure.
Because I don't think geography matters really anymore in that sense, you know, in a strange way, because you can be sitting wherever you are in India. You could be sitting in a metro, you could be sitting in a small town, you could be sitting in the interiors of a forest. If you have Wi-Fi, you're as connected to anywhere in the world as you can be. So your style influence could come from underground subculture in the US, or what's happening at the shows in Milan, or what is happening in of you know in Bollywood, or history, or wherever, as long as you have access to it.
Correct. So I also feel, and it's a comment, that do you think the confidence level also has to do a lot with it, because you are now very confident of what Make in India is. So rather than wearing an LBD, which was like the norm, or in a corporate dressing, you were wearing like straight cuts dresses that was required. Now people are easy wearing handlooms, even at a cocktail party, or probably they are okay wearing a handloom dress even to a corporate boardroom meeting.
You know, confidence comes a lot from the state of your country and the state of your economy. So as India as an economy has blossomed in the last decade, and as you're seeing more access, more travel, confidence comes from not having to be validated by somebody else and sort of feeling content with yourself. So as more confidence comes in from the national growth and parallelly towards the opportunities that it provides to the population, the more you see people looking inward and feeling satisfied rather than having to wear something which everybody in the world is sort of is says okay for. And somewhere at that point also, I think it's great, because I think Indian bodies, especially the kind of clothes which I make, which you'll see all in the racks around, we are very unique as a demographic. The kind of clothes which work on Indian women, international brands don't necessarily understand that.
That's true.
Like, you look at a lot of international brands, the women are much more athletic. They're big-shouldered, small-hipped. On the other hand, a lot of Indians are pear-shaped. So the kind of clothes which not only look good on us, but also that we inherently feel at home in, is very different from what Western brands necessarily provide. So what we are finding is a gap in that market, because we are learning to accept ourselves rather than trying to stuff ourselves into stereotypes and parameters of what has always been considered okay. Like, I remember this, I think a couple of years ago, you know, it was sweltering in Mumbai in summer, and I was seeing people lined up to go to office in, you know, in like you know, synthetic fabric pants or a full shirt with a tie waiting at a bus stop. And I'm like, you know, we have such an enormous colonial hangover that in 40 degree, 100% humidity, you're wearing something which was proposed by colonizers 150 years ago without understanding that maybe just a beautiful cotton kurta or a kurta variation or a trousers would be so much nicer for you than sort of sweltering in what is just not us, you know.
Precisely. That's very interesting. So the inclusivity part, we come to kind of discuss on that. So there's a lot of discussion happening around gender fluid clothes, and probably people are really also going on about how inclusive the fashion should be for the bigger sizes, so no body shaming and all of it. And yet there are experiences. So I'll talk about my own experience. You know, I'm on the larger side, you know.
I don't think that's true. I think you are a realistic woman.
So I'll just give you my experience. I've spoken to a couple of designers, and so I would kind of also procure garments for shoots, obviously, which were done on some other people. But the moment they will look at you, they'll say, oh, are you going to wear the garment? And you know, for that 1 minute, you're put in a spot. You know, you don't realize like why is that look given. So is there tokenism in photo shoots? You know, because people are talking a lot about how they are size inclusive and gender inclusive. But how is it reflected in the communication? Because neither your photo shoots, neither your ramp walks, none of it communicate that it is inclusive.
You know, firstly, I think I can only speak for myself.
Of course. Of
Secondly,
course.
I think the person who told you that is it for you is totally idiotic. Because I think clothes are to fit the person and not the person fit the clothes.
Precisely.
Like right from my first collection, we've done clothes up to just for a ballpark sizing up to a 6XL.
Right.
Which we, you know, offer off the rack. Like even if you walk around the store today, there's up to a double XL available here, I can very confidently say.
Wow,
and then even the stylish, sexier pieces,
right,
not just what looks like
a
sack.
Covered up. Yeah.
You know, so it's not, because I think firstly, the idea that you have to fit a existing size is so redundant and so stupid that it doesn't even need to be dignified.
Precisely.
Secondly, I feel as a brand, right from the word go, I've always believed the customer who tries my pieces on either comes out smiling when she's coming out of the trial room or comes out really unhappy with herself. And we are not in the business of unhappiness. There's enough unhappiness in the world anyway.
Right.
I'm in the business of providing joy and pleasure.
Right.
So I want whoever's wearing those clothes to feel like the best version of themselves, as opposed to feeling inadequate. My clothes are to cover your so-called imperfections.
Which is the best way.
Which is how it should be.
Precisely. Precisely.
I mean, the clothes have to, it's like going to a doctor and saying, you know, doctor, I have a stomachache. And doctor saying, oh, you poor thing. Like, you know, sorry, we don't treat this. If you feel, you know, you have
supposed to provide a solution.
You are a,
that was a idea.
That's the whole basis of design is is something which creates a solution.
Sure.
It's a problem solving. You know, so that's where it's come. Coming to gender and stuff like that, I think for me, you know, say a trans woman is a woman, so she's free to shop from whatever. I don't think we need a separate kind of a category, because that by itself is discrimination. Just the fact that you can come and shop from whatever that you have is available, or tomorrow if a man wants to wear say one of my jackets with say a pair of jeans and a ganji, more power to him.
Yeah.
I think the whole idea of trends and the whole idea of specifying something for someone is kind of fading out, because I think what I offer or what Fashion Today offers is a design buffet.
Yeah.
Where you can pick and choose what you want from.
Correct.
You know, it's your plate is tailor-made to you. You know, we are Indians, we love choice. So at Shadis, we'll have everything from Lebanese to Thai to Italian, and we'll stuff our plates with everything.
Everything.
So similarly, you know, there's so much on offer. You have to curate what works for you, what works for your body type, your lifestyle, your identity, and what makes you, what brings you joy, and shop accordingly.
Brilliant. How important is functionality in your design?
You know, it's like if you watch, go to a buffet, again, since I'm a foodie, and all the food is beautiful and it's entirely made of wax, what good is that? Similarly, I mean, functionality, obviously, it's not something to hang in a museum or as an art piece, as an installation. It's clothes to live your life in.
Yeah.
So they have to be functional. There's no, so we take care of so many things, you know, whether it's sometimes the idea of double hooks.
Yeah.
Just, you know, after, like, you know, on days when you're not feeling your thinnest or you have a little bloating or you had a specially amazing biryani meal. I think it's just good to have that option
of food allergy.
No, because, you know, see, these clothes have to fit into your life. They have to be, they are extremely light.
Yeah.
They're something which can be packed easily. For the bridals and wedding, we do stuff like detachable can-cans. Because, you know, you don't want to travel to a destination wedding and have four suitcases with four lehengas, you know. So, like, stuff like that, you want these clothes to make your life easier, not make it more difficult.
I also read you provide lehengas with pockets.
Absolutely.
Kurtas, which is like the most important
design
thing that like, has happened, I feel. You know?
Because like every girl today, I mean, the whole point of it is that lehengas to twirl for Instagram, right?
Yeah.
So, if you need a phone, you need your mints and you need a lipstick.
Yeah.
You can't, and a credit card or a hotel key card or whatever.
Right.
And you don't want to carry a silly clutch in your hand all evening. Or leave it and then be paranoid saying somebody's going to take it away. Just, and there's, God knows there's enough volume in an Indian lehenga for like six pockets and maybe like, you know, a spare dabba to hide.
Exactly.
So I think pockets are the least one can do.
The important ones, yes. So what's your view on the Instagram trend about outfit of the day and the pressure that it has put on a lot of people of not repeating the outfit? Mm. So there's this one camp who believes on not repeating the outfits at all because, hey, it's not cool. Mm. And there's this another camp which is going on about repeat wear and how cool it is.
I think this OOTD and OOTN is 3 years old, so let's leave it there. I think it's done and dusted. Okay. I think clothes are something to be cherished. Clothes are something you make memories in, and clothes are to be reworn. It's not, I'm not creating disposable tissue paper.
Right.
I'm doing stuff which is made with a lot of care, a lot of love, a lot of thought.
Right.
So it, nothing gives me more joy than clothes being repeated not only once, but a dozen times. Like recently for Fashion Week, they're the 20th anniversary.
Hmm.
And my wife wore something from my Gen Next collection, which was created before I met her.
Yeah.
And she wore it and it looked as contemporary, as beautifully made and as classic as ever. So, I mean, that's how you want your clothes to be enjoyed. I hate it when somebody says, I cannot repeat. I'm like, you know, it's not a raincoat. Or like a disposable thing you wear, you know, for a thing.
Yeah.
Or like a hotel, like a hospital overlay. It's something you wear because it brings you, and every time you wear it, it reconnects you to the memory, which I think is so important.
Great. So before we wind up the episode, we would like to know about your latest collection that you're displaying at Deval. What was your inspiration about this collection and what all is at display?
Yeah. So this collection is called Passport Princesses. I just showed this at Fashion Week. And, you know, it's really came from the idea that I think a lot of women have enough anarkalis and enough lehengas to fill a go down.
Yes.
And they want options which are smart, which are different, which they can wear at a wedding, but otherwise as well.
Right.
And the whole idea of, you know, so many, whether it's a landmark birthday or whether it is something important, like there are so many things which involve travel and celebration today.
Absolutely.
That you want clothes which kind of marry that ethos. You want clothes which work on your body type, which work on occasion, which are light to travel. I also do costume design for films, so
my
new film TANAJI is coming out with Ajay Devgan, Saif and Kajol.
Lovely.
In January, and that also somewhere you draw from those experiences where you're designing for a character which is very different from fashion.
Absolutely.
And I think that kind of helped shape this collection because I'm designing for a woman who is global, local.
So you understand the character, you
who's
understand
aware
the audience first.
What her function is, how would she like to sort of, you know, do things. So what I've carried here is a range of course the runway collection. There are heavier, dressier pieces, but there's also tunics which you can wear just beautifully to a lunch, to a simple celebration, to want to wear every day, Diwali, Puja. I've also made sure that the price point is very accessible. So starting at about, say, you know, 15,000 for an outfit, going up to maybe a lakh.
Sure.
You know, so there's something for everyone within tailored, beautiful, well-made clothes, which we'll wear again and again. I think we want something for, I don't want to walk in and feel disappointed, there's nothing for me here. I think that's so important.
Correct. So wish you all the success for this collection and the years to come ahead.
Thank you. Such a pleasure chatting with you.
Such a pleasure. Thank you so much for being on the show. Thank you guys for watching the show. If you like the show, please like, share, comment, subscribe to Ciceroni, your local shopping guide. We're present in Ahmedabad, Baroda and Surat.
And
thank you.
I'll just add to that. And you know, even if you don't want to shop the collection, come have a look. The collection is here for a week. Have a look, touch and feel the clothes and tell us what you think. I think it'll be educative for us.
Thank you.